Our talk today is about diagnosis and management of intrauterine growth restriction. And as usual, we start with the case presentation. Mrs. S.A., a 22-year-old lady, was presented to emergency obstetric unit for being pregnant at her 9th month, with repeated lower abdominal and back pains that had been going on for 2 hours. She was para 1+0 with one living boy that she delivered by cesarean section 2 years before because of breech presentation. She nursed her baby for 1 year and never used any contraceptions. Important points for this lady: she's a young lady, 22 years old, para 1+0, had cesarean section, and it was for non-repeatable cause because she had last time breech presentation. That means if she's cephalic this time with everything all right, she could be given a chance for vaginal delivery. She had regular menstruations for 6 months before getting pregnant, and her last menstrual period corresponded with 38 weeks of gestation. She had irregular antenatal visits and was diagnosed to have mild anemia and was prescribed iron therapy that she failed to take regularly. She was of poor socioeconomic status with no medical or surgical history of clinical relevance apart from her cesarean section. Also, the important points: regular menstruation, that means that she has sure dates, 38 weeks of gestation. She was not a compliant patient to antenatal visits, was diagnosed to have mild anemia, prescribed iron therapy, but she was not taken consistently, and poor socioeconomic status, this is also important, with no other medical or surgical relevant history. Her height was 155 centimeters and weight was 53 kilograms. Her blood pressure was 110/70 with no systemic examination abnormality. Her obstetric examination showed fundal height corresponding to 34 weeks. Symphysis fundal height 28 centimeters. Cephalic presentation with normal fetal heart rate and regular uterine contraction with cervical dilatation of 3 centimeters. Intact membranes and slightly convergent side walls of pelvis on vaginal examination. Also, the important points: that she's rather short, 155 centimeter, blood pressure okay, fundal height smaller than expected, should be at 38 weeks or 32 weeks by SFH measurement. Cephalic presentation, this is normal, but with convergent side wall of pelvis. Otherwise, she was early in labor, cervical dilatation, 3 centimeters, intact membrane. Urgent bedside ultrasound examination revealed an active fetus with average amniotic fluid and estimated fetal weight of 2,300 grams. Urgent CBC revealed hemoglobin of 9.2 gram per deciliter. Now the questions: what's the diagnosis and what's the best management of this condition? And these two questions we are going to answer in the following presentation. So, introduction to IUGR, intrauterine growth restriction. IUGR is a common and complex obstetric problem. constitutes 8 to 10% of all pregnancy, constitutes 50% of preterm stillbirth, 25% of term stillbirth. Prenatal mortality is 8 to 10 times higher for these fetuses, and it is 6 to 30%, as high as that in developing countries. IUGR is the second leading cause of perinatal mortality after preterm delivery, of course, preterm babies. Definition of IUGR is failure of a fetus to reach its full growth potential and has multiple definitions, including estimated fetal weight of less than 10th percentile for gestational age. This is the definition adopted by American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists and Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists. Other definitions include estimated fetal weight less than 2 standard deviations below mean weight for gestational age. According to each area, they have a chart for gestational age, and with this chart, there is 1 standard deviation above and below, 2 standard deviations above and below, and if the weight lies below these 2 standard deviations, then this is considered IUGR. Abdominal circumference also is an important point, especially if less than 10% for gestational age, considered also by some as IUGR. Chondral index, which is an equation, relation between the weight and height, less than the 10th percentile of the normal chondral index. In order to understand the pathophysiology of IUGR, we have to know what's the normal growth pattern of the fetus. It passes into stages, 3 stages. Stage 1, which is stage of hyperplasia, from 4 to 20 weeks. Rapid mitosis, increase of DNA content. Stage 2, hyperplasia and hypertrophy, from 20 to 28 weeks. Mitosis is not so much, but the increase in cell size dominates. And stage 3, hypertrophy, from 28 to 40 weeks. Rapid increase in cell size occurs, rapid accumulation of fat, muscle, and connective tissue. 80% of fetal weight gain occurs during last 20 weeks of gestation. So, what are the determinants of fetal growth? Maternal nutrition and health status, weight and height of the mother, very important. Utero-placental blood flow, the amount of blood that passes through the placenta, and the ability of the placenta to take up substrate, also important. Placental transfer function, umbilical blood flow, fetal endocrine status, and fetal structure. If there is any abnormality in one of these items, then IUGR is anticipated. What are the growth factors involved in the process of growth of the fetus? They are glucose, IGF-1, insulin, growth factor 1, insulin, growth factor 2, thyroxine, cerebral and skeletal thyroxine, leptin, angiogenic factors, and cortisol. Classification. What are the types of IUGR based on onset of pregnancy, cause, and prognosis? IUGR could be either symmetric, early onset, with proportional decrease in all organs. It is around 20% of all cases of IUGR. Asymmetric, Late onset, disproportionate decrease in all organs, with abdominal circumference affected more than the head circumference, and constitutes 80% of all IUGR. Based on ultrasound examination, if we find with ultrasound examination that we have a small fetus, then we are in two options or possibilities: healthy, small for gestational age, that's constitutionally small but healthy baby, or true IUGR, that's pathological, there is a problem with the growth, pathological growth restriction, which could be either type 1, as we mentioned before, type 1, symmetrical, intrinsic IUGR, and type 2, asymmetrical or extrinsic IUGR. Symmetrical IUGR, the 20% part, growth inhibition in stage 1, the hyperplastic stage, leading to reduced number of cells in fetus with normal cell size. Features of the baby are uniformly small. Chondral index, the birth weight divided by the length to the power of 3, normal. Head circumference divided by abdominal circumference in relation to abdominal circumference, normal. Femur length in relation to abdominal circumference, also normal. All small, but the same proportion between all the parts. Now we come to the other limb of the IUGR, the asymmetrical one, which is the more prevalent, the 80% limb. Pathophysiology, growth inhibition in stage 2 or 3, the late stages, the hyperplasia and hypertrophy, decrease in cell size and fetal weight, less effect on total cell number, fetal length, head circumference. The features, the head to the abdomen ratio is increased due to what we know as brain sparing effect. The effect starts in other parts than the brain. Chondral index low. Head circumference in relation to abdominal circumference increased. Femur length in relation to abdominal circumference increased. The length in relation to weight is increased. What are the risk factors for IGR? Maternal risk factors include maternal malnutrition, low socioeconomic status, remember the risk factor in our case, substance abuse like alcohol, maternal body mass index. If it is low body mass index, then there is a possibility of IUGR. Previous history of IUGR, delivery of IUGR baby, smoking, drug use like warfarin, anticonvulsants, antineoplastic agents, and folic acid antagonists, maternal chronic anemia, and excessive caffeine use. Other maternal risk factors include hemoglobinopathies like thalassemia and sickle cell anemia, living in high altitudes with low oxygen, short interpregnancy intervals, repeated pregnancy, another risk factors with our case, ART, assisted reproductive technology, maternal disease conditions like hypertension, diabetes mellitus, renal disease, and preeclampsia. Other risk factors, placental risk factors include placental abruption, chronic placental abruption, placental infarction, fetal villus obliteration, diffuse chronic villitis, inflammation of the villus system, placental hemangioma, a benign tumor of the placenta, single umbilical artery with reduced umbilical blood flow, filamentous cord insertion into the membranes, placental, placenta previa, and chorioangioma, also another placental tumor. Fetal risk factors for IGR include congenital malformations, inborn errors of metabolism, congenital infection, chromosomal abnormalities, multiple pregnancies, 6 more common in females than males, single gene disorders as Fanconi's anemia, a sort of bone marrow suppression disease, and Bloom syndrome with skin abnormality and susceptibility of cancer development. So the diagnosis of IGR relies on the following points. One, establishing accurate dating. You have to be sure that this small baby that you're having is not just because you are miscalculating and the pregnancy occurs at a later stage than you expect. So you have to establish accurate dating first. And the establishment of accurate dating is either by regular menstruation and quite be sure, and the patient is sure of her menstrual period, or by early ultrasound. Number two, identification of the risk factors by obtaining medical history, the risk factors that we mentioned before. Obtaining blood pressure, doing urine analysis, doing the symphysis fundal height and the abdominal girth, infectious workup, full blood count, and then ultrasound, the important part is to do the biometry, head circumference, abdominal circumference, femur length, and in relation to abdominal circumference ratio and the biparietal diameter. Also, we may perform the fetal ponderal index by ultrasound, as we mentioned before. Amniocentesis is a maneuver performed about 20 to 24 weeks where we take an amniotic fluid sample in order to test for abnormal chemistry present that is more common with some congenital malformation, and also in order to detect the blood that detect the fetal cells for chromosomal study. Other include serum triple test screening for aneuploidy, especially trisomy 21 or Down syndrome. And the triple test, we do 3 tests at the same time, which are alpha fetoprotein, estriol, and beta HCG measurements for diagnosis of aneuploidy, especially Down syndrome. If we diagnose a case of IUGR, what's the best management? First, after we make sure that this is a true case of IUGR, we have the best treatment is to terminate pregnancy, and that is easy decision to take if we are near to term. But if we are far from it, then this is a paradox, a problem. Because if we leave the baby, then there is a risk of intrauterine fetal death. And if we take it out prematurely, then there is a risk of neonatal complications and neonatal death. And the important point is the level of experience or expertise of the neonatal unit. If we have a good neonatal unit capable of taking care of early of small babies, then the choice is easier. And in all situation, the paternal parental counseling is important. Taking the opinion of the mother and father of the parents is important as well. Each case must be individualized, and investigation of underlying causes like major congenital anomalies or chromosomal abnormalities that is incompatible with life is also important. So if we decide that it is not yet the proper time to deliver the fetus, then what are we going to do? We are going to do the fetal surveillance tests as frequently as possible, including the fetal movement count or fetal kick count, the biophysical profile or modified biophysical profile that should be done once or twice weekly, serial ultrasonography weekly for growth and Doppler studies. This is important also to make sure that the placental blood flow is adequate and it can give you an idea about the level of compromise of the fetus. Generally speaking, if we have a good Doppler indices that can give us a time for 1 week to leave the fetus in utero. And these Doppler studies include recording the blood flow in the following vessels: umbilical artery, uterine artery, middle cerebral artery, ductus venosus, and descending aorta. And as we mentioned before, what's the best time of delivery? This is quite variant depending on the condition of the fetus and the experience of the neonatal unit that we have. There's no effective intervention to alter the course of fetal growth restriction, of course, except for delivery. And the risk of fetal hypoxemia and acidemia and intrauterine fetal death versus complications of prematurity must be weighed. We have to look for evidence of fetal lung maturity. If we find evidence of fetal lung maturity by ultrasound or by amniocentesis, then it is proper to ensue delivery, and delivery should be considered at or near term. Usually we perform at 37 weeks, maybe at 38 weeks if everything is okay, but before that, if we find that the baby is starting to be compromised, must be in a center with facilities for cesarean section and neonatal care. Management of IUGR near term. So the question is, or the problem is easier here, because prompt delivery is likely the best solution for the condition. And we may start thinking of delivery after 34 weeks, and that's based on the performance of the neonatal unit that we have. If we have a good neonatal unit, then we can consider delivery at 34 weeks, which is reasonable timing. With reassuring fetal severance, vaginal delivery may be attempted. That means that IUGR is no indication for cesarean section per se. But if we have another problem, like if we have a cesarean section before, then the best treatment is to do cesarean section. Expectant management can be guided using antepartum fetal surveillance test that we mentioned before. If we detect the condition remote from term, then the problem is more complicated because of a higher incidence of neonatal complications and death. Observation, of course, is recommended while doing fetal surveillance. We have to look for underlying etiology, as we mentioned before. Management decision depends on relative risk of fetal death versus preterm delivery. And unfortunately, there is no specific treatment measure that ameliorates the condition. Suggested treatment measures for IUGR: admission, bed rest, admission to hospital, of course, bed rest in left lateral position, improving diet, cessation of alcohol and illicit drugs, cessation of smoking, giving corticosteroids at an early time to help to develop the lung maturity, frequent antenatal visits, of course, bi-weekly ultrasonography for estimated fetal weight and for fetal growth, other drugs that are suggested to be used include aspirin, nitric oxide donors, phosphodiesterase inhibitors like sildenafil, Viagra, and magnesium sulfate. All of these are tried, but with no much significant efficacy that we can say it is a good treatment. A comment on the mode of delivery. Every case must be individualized. Determinants for the mode of delivery include underlying etiology, gestational age, if extreme prematurity, then cesarean section is better, severity of IUGR, with severe IUGR, better to do cesarean section, fetal surveillance, if there is compromised fetus, then cesarean section is resorted to, and the facilities available. If we have other obstetric factors like malpresentation, then cesarean section is better. Cesarean section better with severe growth restriction. What are the complications for the neonate? And the complications include prematurity and the risk of prematurity, perinatal asphyxia, meconium aspiration, neonatal sepsis, necrotizing enterocolitis, stillbirth, sudden infant death syndrome, increased perinatal morbidity and mortality. Long-term complications for the newborn include risk of ischemic heart disease, stroke, hypertension, diabetes mellitus, metabolic syndrome, late in life, low IQ, short stature in adult life, and poor neurologic and cognitive function.